Hallelujah, thine the glory, revive us again. Good morning and good day to you, brothers and sisters. Going to show you something cool as always. This lesson, we're going to take a very detailed look at the 45 days of the seventh trumpet period. Now, we do know that those 45 days are going to be shortened, those established 45 days. And of course, we get those 45 days of the seventh trumpet from Daniel chapter 12, as well as other places. But in this lesson, as we take a detailed look, probably more detailed than anyone has ever looked at it before, at least that I've seen on the internet or heard many preachers talk on this subject, we're going to look at all the aspects of these 45 days, shortened 45 days, such as, does Jesus break through the atmosphere at the blowing of the seventh trumpet? Does he wait until the seventh bowl is poured and all the nations have been gathered to the wedding hall, the valley of Armageddon around the hill of Nazareth? What about the weapons of indignation that we see in Isaiah 13 and Jeremiah 50? Who are the weapons of indignation? Are they man of dust bodies? Armies? Are they the armies of heaven? Are they a combination of the two? In this lesson, we'll also be getting a very good understanding of what's going on in Revelation chapter 14, even though it's positioned where it is between the blowing of the seventh trumpet and the seventh bowl, which begins the battle of the great day of God Almighty. So we're going to understand these titles, such as the weapons of his indignation. We're going to look at who are the my sanctified ones, who are the my mighty ones. That I have gotten wrong for several weeks, maybe even a few months now. I got wrong who was the my mighty ones of Isaiah 13. All right, I was confusing that with that assembly of great nations from the north mentioned in Jeremiah 50 and 49 and Jeremiah 51. So we're going to get all of these titles straight. We're going to understand when Jesus comes. We're going to understand who Babylon the great city is, that old harlot. If you've seen any of my other videos before, you know who Babylon the great city in the last days are, and you know how I've proved it. But we're going to be answering all of those questions in this lesson. In this lesson, we'll primarily be, besides the book of Revelation, we'll primarily be in Isaiah 13 and Jeremiah 50 and Jeremiah 51. Let's go ahead and get started. Let's start out right here in Isaiah chapter 13. The vast majority of the book of Isaiah is all about our future. The primary fulfillment of these prophecies are all about the revealing of Jesus Christ at the end of the 70th week of Daniel. People don't understand that. They think it's more past prophecy than it is future prophecy, but that's not the case. We're going to start out in Isaiah 13. This is the burden against Babylon. This is not Babylon in the past. This is the burden against Babylon, the great city, in the future. And this chapter is all about the return of Christ at the end of the age. Remember, the end of the age does not mean the end of the world, even though the King James Version in some places does word it that way. It's worded more correctly in the New King James Version, where you see it is the end of the age, because the millennium is going to take place here on planet Earth for 1,000 years. And there's many ways to prove that. I'll do that in another lesson, that the millennium is real. It's not like a period of time, say, that the Seventh-day Adventists, they believe that we're going to heaven for 1,000 years to learn and then come back. And so they're mistaken about that. The Church of God, well, not all the Church of God. I shouldn't say that. I'm not sure what many of them believe, but the offshoots of Herbert W. Armstrong, which are more correct about a lot of the Bible than most other denominations. So I got to give them a shout out. But they are mistaken on the return of Jesus Christ, his glorious appearing. They tend to believe that it's at the seventh trumpet blast by the seventh angel. and Jesus is conquering for the entire 45-day period, which will be shortened. But that's not correct. The battle of the great day of God Almighty begins at the pouring of the seventh bowl. The very first day is the last day of the age, and then there'll be many days and nights after that. The first many days and nights of the millennium is when Jesus is and the armies of heaven, along with his weapons of indignation, are threshing Father's land from the Euphrates River to the Nile. And if you ever want to see the route of the threshing, you would look at Isaiah 27:12. Since we're on this page, I'll point out what you see here in Isaiah 11:11. Isaiah 11:11, just since I'm on this page, shows you many of the cities that belong to the beast kingdom, which will be threshed during the many days that Jesus and the armies of heaven are threshing the Middle East. You see these. These are where the Israeli slaves, many of them, are going to be sent to. And the remnant shall be gathered one by one over a period of many days while Jesus and his armies of heaven, glorified armies, teaming up with what's called the man of dust bodies of the weapons of indignation used by Father. You see that as listed as the assembly of great nations from the north in Jeremiah 15:51. Probably countries like America. Can't say for sure. But I wanted to point that out to you in Isaiah 11:11. That's a lot of the major cities that are going to be involved in the beast kingdom here coming up in the future, the 70th week of Daniel. And it talks about Shinar. Of course, that's Baghdad and Elam. That's southwest Iran. And we have Assyria and Egypt are all going to be involved. Of course, Egypt's going to be defeated right at the tail end of the fifth seal. Please see my lesson on that. But let's get started with Isaiah 13, this burden against Babylon the Great in the 70th week of Daniel. That we're not talking about King Nebuchadnezzar here. This is the return of Christ. So let's go ahead and read Isaiah 13, and then we'll take a look at Revelation 14 and Revelation 19. Then we'll move to Jeremiah. But I really need you to understand once and for all who the My Mighty Ones are, who are the My Sanctified Ones, who are the weapons of indignation. Again, glorified man of dust or a combination of the two. And when does Jesus return? And what does he do upon his return? All of these things are found in these passages. I'll go ahead and tell you this. Jesus, upon his return, is doing a lot more than just hugging and kissing his glorified bride and bringing peace to the world. Okay, he's doing a lot more than that. The initial many days, as Isaiah 28 calls it, the initial many days of the millennium, Jesus is threshing the land, defeating the beast cities. It takes more than one night. I used to think it only took one night, till I read passages like Isaiah 28. Then I learned that these whirlwinds of the Lord, the glory of the Lord, the it that shall happen, his staff of punishment, it will go from city to city for many days during the millennium. And gathering the remnant slaves of Israel, who were not glorified because their lamps were not lit, but they will be checked for the mark of the beast. And Jesus will, as he goes from city to city, will be blowing fire and brimstone on all those who take the mark. Revelation 14, verses 9 through 11. I used to think he did it all in one night, at one time. Bam, here comes this stream going all around the planet at one time. Well, that's not the case. As he's visiting these cities, and you see him here in Isaiah 11:11, and you also see the route of the whirlwinds, the route of Jesus' dance with his beautiful bride. You see it in Isaiah 27:12, from Baghdad to Cairo, all these cities are going to be visited. Again, Isaiah 28 proves that it's over a period of many days. The last day of the age is when Jesus returns. And he will take care of the mountains of Israel and Jerusalem, the holy city, on the first night. We will be gathered together, Micah 5 says, over Bethlehem Ephrathah, the well of Bethlehem, over Jesse's house, the root of Jesse, power from the Ancient of Days Father will spring up, will flow up through Jesus, the root of the tree of life, and all the elect branches on the tree. It doesn't matter which flock you are, natural or wild grafted on adopted, it doesn't matter. When that power is applied to the root of Jesse, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, all elect branches on the tree will be resurrected to life. And if you are alive and remain, you will be raptured, caught up, spared, lifted up, took up, up to that meet location on the top of the storm cloud above Bethlehem Ephrathah and the whirlwinds of the Lord. Numbers chapter 9 and 10 tell us there's four whirlwinds of the Lord that are going to be going out. That is Zechariah 9. Talks about these whirlwinds coming from the south, from the perspective of the inhabitants of Jerusalem, looking southward towards Bethlehem Ephrathah, the original city of David. They look up in the sky, and here comes the Lord coming with all his saints from the well of Bethlehem at high altitude to low altitude to defend the city of Jerusalem on the first night, the mountains of Israel, the winepress around the hill of Nazareth. All of that will be taken care of the first night. Jesus arrives shortly before eventide over Jerusalem to start defending the mountains of Israel and the holy city. Did you know that? Eventide, evening time, twilight, the sacrifice, hallelujah, will begin. Who's being sacrificed? The bulls of Bashan. All right, all these marked ones coming against Israel. All right, they will be the sacrifice on the mountains of Israel at twilight, evening tide, evening time. That's Isaiah 17:14, Zechariah 14:7. That's going to be the sacrifice. Now, let's see. All right, let's go ahead and get started with Isaiah 13. The burden against Babylon, which Isaiah the son of Amoz. Make sure we can see this. Verse 2. The son of Amoz saw, lift up a banner on the high mountain. Raise your voice to them. Wave your hand that they may enter the gates of the nobles. All right. What are we talking about? The gates of the nobles. This is Babylon, the great city, the mother of all harlots. All right. Is being attacked. This is what you see at the end of Revelation, chapters like Isaiah 17, Isaiah 18, it's all about the battle of the great day of God Almighty, which does not begin until the seventh bowl is poured. All right, the seventh trumpet that you see announcing something, along with the court reporters called the three angels who go out and make proclamations around the world. That happens at the seventh trumpet right after Elijah and Moses are seen rising from the streets of Jerusalem. All right, the 42-month period is over at the blast of the seventh trumpet. What has happened besides Elijah and Moses coming back to life and the world seeing it, probably on TV or YouTube going viral? There they are, raising up. What's going on? Well, you get your answer in Daniel chapter 7. We won't go there in this lesson. But that's when Father begins watching the events of the 70th week of Daniel, not at the start of the 70th week, but the court is in session. Father, the Ancient of Days, is seated along with the other thrones, which belong to the 24 elders. They are watching, beginning at the pompous words. That's what it says in Daniel 6 and 7. At the pompous words, the blasphemies, at the fifth seal, when Satan has been taken over by Leviathan, Gog the Antichrist, the wicked prince of Israel, that wicked counselor, the worthless shepherd, the foolish shepherd, that Israel will accept as their wicked prince instead of Jesus, he will be taken over by Satan during the fifth seal. That's when he will begin to speak blasphemies and pompous words. That is when the court in heaven you see in Daniel chapter 7 comes into session. And for 42 months, which leads up to the blast of the seventh trumpet, that is when the Ancient of Days, along with the 24 elders, is watching and it's time for Father. He says he's seen enough. By the time the seventh trumpet occurs, Jerusalem will begin shaking. 7,000 people will die, the book of Revelation tells us. One-tenth of the city shall fall. Elijah and Moses will be seen rising by their enemies. It'll go viral. And then the angels go forth to make the three proclamations to the world about how Jesus has been awarded a kingdom and a dominion, and the earth now belongs to Jesus. It's official. Father, the Ancient of Days has reached a verdict judgment in favor of Jesus and his saints. All right, but we are told that in Revelation, as well as other places, we must continue. Those who belong to Father, who are still here, must wait patiently until Jesus is appearing. Jesus does not appear at the blast of the seventh trumpet. That's one of the things that the offshoots of Herbert W. Armstrong Worldwide Church of God have wrong. Okay, Jesus does not appear until the pouring of the seventh bowl. But Jesus, who now owns the planet as of the decision that's reached at the blowing of the seventh trumpet by Father the Ancient of Days. You see that in Daniel 7 at the seventh trumpet. Now it belongs to Jesus. He does not appear until 45 days later. That amount of days, however, will be shortened. Those established days mentioned in Daniel 12 will be shortened according to Matthew 24. Why? Because if Jesus waited any longer, then the inhabitants of Jerusalem would all be dead. He does not want that to happen. There are some in there that he wants to, number one, never taste death, and number two, some he wants to get out of there, even though their lamps are not lit, that they do not have the mark of the beast, and he will split the Mount of Olives, according to Zechariah 14, and allow them to escape 3 miles east to Bethany, Azal, Isaria today on Google Earth. So, who is Babylon the great city during the 70th week of Daniel? Well, it was Baghdad in the past. Remember King Nebuchadnezzar? Is it Baghdad once again? And the answer is yes, and there is multiple ways to prove that. The first is to take Revelation 18:21 and match that up with Jeremiah 51, verses 62 through 64. You see, Father, in Revelation 18 is pointing you, purposely pointing you back to Jeremiah 51, verses 62 through 64. But in Jeremiah 51, Father gives you the city that passes through this Babylon, the great city of the latter days. And what is it? It's the Euphrates River. So, we know that Baghdad is the Babylon, the great city, once again, just like in the past. And Father proved it by Revelation 18:21. Now, another way to prove it is Zechariah 5. Zechariah 5 talks about how this image is going to be set on its base in the land of Shinar, this basket of wickedness that brings about the curse, okay, and marking the perjurers. This hour of trial, mark of the beast, test that shall go forth. Daniel 11:39 says to acknowledge and advance its glory. It says it'll be set on its base in the land of Shinar. Well, that is Baghdad. Always has been, always will be. And there are numerous verses that talk about the beast kingdom, about their main command structure is in the land of the Chaldeans. Okay? That, again, is the Baghdad basin where the Euphrates and the Tigris join at Baghdad prior to going and flowing into the Persian Gulf where the fornication with the nations shall take place. Also, another way to prove that it's Baghdad is Isaiah 27:12. It says that Jesus and his armies of heaven will, after they're done with the mountains of Israel, will begin threshing from Baghdad. That's the channel of the river. The river always means the Euphrates River. And it says, Jesus and his armies will thresh from Baghdad, the channel of the river, to the brook of Egypt, which is Cairo, the Nile River. So, remember, the borders of Father's land is always the Euphrates River and the Nile River. So Father is going to use Jesus, the commander of the Lord's army, Joshua chapter 5. He in Revelation 19 and Isaiah 13 talks about Jesus commanding his army here in Isaiah 13. We'll see that here in just a second. But I'm explaining to you different ways that you can prove that Baghdad was and will be a Babylon, the great city, once again. So just by the route of the threshing, by the fact that Zechariah 5 talks about this image being set up on its base in the land of Shinar, Baghdad, because Revelation 18:21 matches Jeremiah 51 verses 62 through 64 and names the river. So there's lots of ways we can tell Baghdad is going to be Babylon, the great city in the latter days. In fact, Russia, who has moved into the Middle East now permanently, is joining forces with Syria and Iraq, and they're forming a command center in Baghdad. Even though we seem to have a lot of influence over the Iraqi army right now, that's not going to last. Unless we become, at least temporarily, part of the King of the North Assyrian Alliance, which I don't think is going to happen, but you never know with our country, especially if the Democratic Party, all right, the Democratic Party is going to vote today on who their new leader is. Today is, let's see, what is today's date? It's Saturday, I believe, the 25th, I think, of February. All right, they're going to vote today. They may be choosing a Muslim to lead the Democratic Party over the next several years. If that happens today, I wouldn't be surprised if Trump does not get reelected. All right. And if the Democratic Party comes back into power and they're led by a Muslim, who knows what's in store for America and where our allegiances will be in the future. Something to think about. I hate to bring up politics because a follower of Jesus is a follower of Jesus. It doesn't matter what your political affiliation is. But I mention that because of who it looks like the Democrats are going to choose today as their leader for the near future. That's why I brought that up. If you're a Democrat, I hope you'll continue to watch this lesson. Because you're going to have to put up with me for hundreds of trillions of years, for eternity. So, verse 2, lift up a banner on the high mountain, raise your voice to them, wave your hand that they may enter the gates of the nobles. You notice here that the your is not capitalized. I am reading from the New King James Version, and the New King James Version, I believe, number one, is the best version to study the 70th week of Daniel. I have many, many reasons why I think that. Their capitalization is always spot on. Here you see the your is not capitalized. That means we're talking about a man. Raise your voice to them. We're getting ready to see who the them are. Wave your hand that they may enter the gates of the nobles. When we go to Jeremiah 51, brothers and sisters, you're going to see who that person is that the Bible is talking about being in charge over a lot of people who's going to be attacking Baghdad at the end of the seventh trumpet period, as Jesus breaks through the atmosphere and handles things the first night in Jerusalem and the mountains of Israel, to include the wine press around Nazareth, but also the many nights of the millennium, the first many nights of the millennium, Jesus and his armies will go eastward to Baghdad and then thresh backward towards Cairo. Again, that's Isaiah 27:12. What this man is, he's actually called a general in Jeremiah 51. He is appointed by Almighty God to lead the man of dust armies, this assembly of great nation from the north. We see in Jeremiah 50 and 51, he's going to lead them against Baghdad and the beast cities. Okay? And he's going to prep. He's going to help defeat Baghdad, but he is going to be helped by Jesus and his armies of heaven are going to be teaming up with this man of dust assembly of great nations to bring about the fall. You may say, well, can't Jesus handle it on his own? Does he really need the angels? Does he really need his my sanctified bride army? Does he really need man of dust general and armies to help him? Of course he doesn't. But it is his decision, it's Father's decision, to use all of these different armies to bring about the fall of the beast kingdom. It is. It's Father's decision. That's what he has decided to do. So you're going to have glorified Israel, which is the tree of life. Remember, the tree of life is not natural. It doesn't have natural branches and adopted branches, because once a wild olive tree living branch is grafted onto the tree of life by Father, the final vine dresser, once that happens, you Gentile grafted on wild branch, you are now Israel, my elect. My people Israel, my elect, is every branch on that tree. And get used to being called Israel, Zion, my people, my inheritance. There's only one tree. There's not two trees that get harvested at the return of Jesus. I know you're getting a lot in this lesson, but this banner is being lifted by this general you see in Jeremiah 51. Let's continue on. And of course, the gates here is talking about Baghdad, because Baghdad's going to be surrounded at the end of the 70th week and the first many nights of the millennium. Baghdad will be destroyed. I have commanded. Who's this talking? This is Jesus talking. I have commanded my, capital M, sanctified ones. Who are the sanctified ones? And you may say, oh, well, we know that Father sanctifies Israel. And there's verses that say that Israel, with you, you shall be my battle axe. You, with you, Israel, I shall break in pieces. And we'll see that when we go to Jeremiah 51. But you need to understand, using Romans 9, Romans 11, Galatians 3, the book of Hebrews, you find out who Israel is. Israel is not the nation of Israel. Israel is every elect branch who is alive on the tree of life. Remember Romans 9, I think it's verse 6, okay? Once you are grafted onto the tree of life by Father, the final vine dresser, you want to know where I get that term or title from, look at John chapter 15, verses 1 and 2, and again, Romans 9, Romans 11, Hebrews, Galatians, and you find out who you are. The name of the tree of life is Israel, my elect. So, I have commanded my sanctified ones. That is the bride army you see in Revelation 19. Revelation 19 says that the bride of Christ is dressed in fine linen, clean and bright initially at the flash of glorification. That's verse 8 of Revelation 19. And then later on in Revelation 19, that clean and bright fades to clean and white. That's just an interesting thing that you need to pick up. The King James Version blew it. I don't mean to pick on the King James Version, but that they blew. Why? Because in Revelation 19, verse 8, it doesn't say clean and bright. It just says clean and white. And you may say, well, is it a big deal? I guess not. But when you want to know when the flash of glorification comes, if you really care that much about the Word of God and you really like to uncover these golden nuggets and these clues, then it becomes important. So again, that's just one of 100 reasons why I would use the New King James Version if you truly have a desire to study the 70th week. But the My Sanctified Ones, Jesus commands personally. The My Sanctified Ones are, for the most part, they're people who have never fought in a war. They don't have military experience. They could be that little old lady who sits on the second pew. And you'll see in a second why I word it that way. My sanctified ones. Psalm 110. Let's go there right now. Something I got to show you. Psalm 110 says that the bride of Christ will not be forced to fight during the day of his power at the battle of the great day of God Almighty when he begins the many days battle to defeat the beast cities. Here in Psalm 110, all right, we see that, I'll start reading with verse 1, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. All right, when does this happen? This is the battle of the great day of God Almighty at the end of the age and the first many days of the millennium. The Lord shall send the rod of your strength out of Zion. Rule in the midst of your enemies, okay? Rule. This is the millennium, the first many days. Your people shall be volunteers in the day of your power. There's only the day of your power is at the end of the age, beginning with the last day of this age and the first many days of the millennium. That is the time of his power, when he's breathing fire and brimstone, and people see the glory of the Lord as it goes from city to city in the Middle East between the Euphrates River and the Nile River. Don't forget the Nile River goes all the way southward to Cush, Ethiopia, Sudan, where the Nile River begins. And Father's Land also goes as far north as Ararat, okay, that mountain range, all right, where the Euphrates River begins. This is all Father's Land that shall be threshed, Isaiah 27:12 says. But shall be volunteers in the day of your power. We know when your power is. That's when these four whirlwinds of the Lord, these Cat 5 tornadoes, are going forth threshing the Middle East and gathering the Israeli slave remnant one by one and flee. During that time, these beast cities, get out while you can. Who's going to help? Pay attention, brothers and sisters, if I'm starting to lose you, wake back up. Who's going to help the Israeli slaves begin to break their bonds and allow them to flee before Jesus and the armies of heaven arrive so that Jesus can blow fire on all the marked ones and to purify these cities? Who is it that's going to break the bonds of the Israeli slaves at least maybe 12 hours in advance or 24 hours in advance of Jesus' arrival with his whirlwinds of the Lord? Who's going to break their bonds? It's going to be this assembly of great nations from the north mentioned in Jeremiah 50 and 51. Some people refer to them as the Crusaders coming back. All right, I like to think so. Probably rejoice at the exaltation of Yah, the Holy One of Israel, and of Jesus. Here they come. In fact, when we get to Jeremiah 51, we'll see that all the passages of Baghdad are blocked. They are trapped just in time for Jesus' arrival. These are man of dust crusaders, if you will. The Bible says in Jeremiah 49, 50, and 51 that these crusaders, the assembly of great nations from the north, will team up with the spirit of the Medes. Well, who are the descendants of the Medes? It's the Kurds today who you see siding with America. Hallelujah. We're getting close, brothers and sisters. You need to wake up. So continuing on with Isaiah 13, I have commanded my sanctified ones. Here we're talking about the day of your power when Jesus has broke through the atmosphere above Bethlehem Ephrathah and has begun threshing, treading, and trampling the mountains of Israel and the cities that belong to the beast kingdom. Now, what does it say after I have commanded my sanctified ones? It says, I have also called my mighty ones for my anger. I used to think that was the man of dust body, my assembly of great nations, the crusaders, all right, who come from the north to trap and begin the process of freeing Israeli slaves. To have them ready, to have all these cities ready for Jesus' arrival to finish the treading and trampling and threshing. But I now believe that the My Mighty Ones is a portion, is a section of the bride army but it's a special session of the bride army. These are the people who have literally died. They have died for Yah. All right, Lord God Yah the Father and Lord God Yah Jesus Christ. The My Mighty Ones have fought in battle, or they have at the knife at the back of their throat, not denied Jesus, because a lot of the My Sanctified Ones, they didn't have to die for Jesus. They have died, and they've been waiting under the altar. But these My Mighty Ones have gone through battle and died on behalf, all right, of Yah, the God of Israel, the Holy One of Israel, and His Son Jesus, all right? For example, and it does say, those who rejoice at My exaltation. My Mighty Ones, I need you to think of them as warriors who have fought for God. Remember, God gave the command, you shall go forth and you will fight against such and such tribe and you will kill every last one of them. I'm commanding you to do it. There's no sin in it. In fact, I need you to do it because I need you to serve Me in this land, and none of them who worship false gods can be permitted in My land. So all of the hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people who have gone to war, not the ones who think they're doing God's will, but the ones who have actually done God's will, cleansing the land between the Euphrates and the Nile. Think of all of those soldiers of Israel long ago who fought and under the orders of Almighty God and who were killed, because not every battle resulted in no Israeli losses. Sometimes, even though Israel won, their losses were high. All right? So anyone who has died fighting or has died on behalf of God and His Son Jesus, Lord God Jesus, they get a special title of My Mighty Ones. But this mainly is for those who understand already the art of war, like a SEAL team or special ops maybe, all right, or Rangers or 82nd Airborne or whoever. These people are experienced warriors and they died fighting for Father. Now keep that in mind. Keep your spot there in Isaiah 13. Now Ezekiel 37 makes more sense. Let's look at Isaiah 37, particularly verse 10, when Almighty God, at the pouring of the seventh bowl, will make this exceedingly great army stand on its feet. All right. We are in Ezekiel 37, and there's a great song that's just come out by, what's the young lady's name? Lauren, what is it, Daigle or something like that? Anyways, she's an awesome singer, and she has that song, Come Alive, talking about the dry bones. This is it. This is exactly what she's singing about here in Ezekiel 37, especially verse 10. This exceedingly great army, suddenly, in an instant, in the twinkling of an eye, will begin to rattle, all right, and meet the Lord up in the air. And it says, so I prophesied as He commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army. They're going to stand on the cloud with the Lord. The glory of the Lord shall be seen at the meet location above Bethlehem Ephrathah, Micah chapter 5. They're going to stand on their feet. This is talking about the My Mighty Ones. Now, that doesn't mean that they're the only ones that get resurrected to life, brothers and sisters. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying that Father brings pleasure on bringing them back to life. They are experienced warriors. All right? Now, there's only going to be four whirlwinds of the Lord. We know that from Numbers chapter 10. Just like when Israel, my people Israel, were sent out the very first time by Almighty God to do his bidding to defeat the enemy, they went out in four whirlwinds, four banners. All right, three tribes were attached, assigned to each banner. That's how it's going to be above Bethlehem Ephrathah when we go forth. And the inhabitants of Jerusalem, Zechariah 14 tells us when Jesus comes back, half of the city of Jerusalem's already have gone through the open gap in the gate and will be taken away on Toyota pickup trucks to the beast cities to be slaves. Now remember, the nation of Israel spent from the first trumpet all the way to the seventh bowl being defeated and being taken away as slaves. Zechariah 13 says that two out of three people in Israel will die due to pestilence, famine, disease, war. And then the one out of three will be taken away to the beast cities. Don't forget about Isaiah 11:11, showing you a list of some of the regions in the Middle East where these slaves are going to be going to. Hallelujah. Don't forget about that. And lost my train of thought. Give me 1 second. What were we talking about? All right, the My Mighty Ones, the exceedingly great army that stands on its feet, all right, they're going to be up there. They are taking part in the resurrection to life. They're just one group. These four whirlwinds, that's what we were talking about, shall go forth. Now, in these whirlwinds, you'll have the My Sanctified Ones, all right? Alongside the My Mighty Ones in these four groups, these four Cat 5 tornado-like whirlwinds that's threshing the land, My Sanctified Ones, if they volunteer, don't forget about Psalm 110, they'll be led by the My Mighty Ones, the experienced warriors, war-fighting warriors of Almighty God from the past who will be brought back to life. So Judah, we're told, the one of the four whirlwinds that Judah is assigned to, and again, you see the assigning of the order of march in Numbers chapter 10. All right, and Judah, the whirlwind that they are assigned to, that group of four of the tribes that's assigned to Judah's, they will be the royal horse in battle. They will go forth first. But I don't want you to think that the bride does not fight. If they volunteer, the My Sanctified Ones, part of the bride, the My Mighty Ones are part of the bride too, but they will be led by the My Mighty Ones, who Father takes pride in bringing them back to life and using them to thresh his land from the Euphrates to the Nile, just like they were supposed to do all those years ago, but failed due to sin. All right? But they will be successful this time. I hope that helps you understand what's going on at the resurrection to life and where it takes place and when it takes place, what's going on in Ezekiel 37, who the My Mighty Ones are of Isaiah 13. Let's go back to Isaiah 13 and continue talking about the seventh trumpet period. Anytime we're talking about the seventh trumpet period, brothers and sisters, you need to understand that the last trumpet is not the blowing of the seventh trumpet by the seventh angel to announce Daniel 7's courtroom verdict judgment that you see in Revelation 11. And you see in Revelation when it talks about these three angels going forth and making these proclamations, Baghdad has fallen, Babylon has fallen. Well, it does not fall at the blowing of the seventh trumpet. They're making the... See, when Father speaks a judgment, it's as if it had already happened. Does that make sense? When he speaks something like Baghdad or Babylon the Great has fallen, it's a done deal, even though it hasn't actually happened yet. Does that make sense? We know for sure that the last trumpet is blown at the pouring of the seventh bowl. There's many ways we can prove that. How do we prove that? Well, first of all, you got to understand Matthew 22. Matthew 22 talks about the gathering of the nations. The nations have been gathered together. You see that all throughout Scripture. And Joel 3, and in Micah, and Revelation. And Revelation 16, when it talks about the sixth bowl being used to gather the nations to where? Armageddon around the hill of Nazareth. Matthew 22 is talking about the same thing. And it says that the good and bad will be gathered into the wedding hall. And then Revelation 16, 15, and 16 and 17, at the end of the sixth bowl there, it's talking about the wedding hall being the Valley of Decision, the Valley of Jehoshaphat, the Valley of Jezreel, the Valley of Armageddon, the Valley of Megiddo. That's all the wedding hall around the hill of Nazareth, and Jesus and his armies take care of it that first night. When the 70 weeks are completed, when the seventh bowl is blown, the 70th weeks are completed, and the iniquities of Israel has come to an end. Transgressions, the end of sin. Now it's time to thresh for the first many days in the millennium. But Zechariah, let's go ahead and turn there real quick. Zechariah, there towards the end of the Old Testament, Zechariah 9 verse 14 is the blowing of the last trumpet by Jesus himself. If you've ever read over that and go, wow, that kind of sounds like the last trumpet, but it doesn't say it's the last trumpet. Well, it is the last trumpet, and it's blown by Lord God Jesus. Zechariah 9, okay, here we are in Zechariah 9, it's verse 14. Then the Lord will be seen over them, and his arrow will go forth like lightning. That's the lightning spoken of in Matthew 24. The Lord God, this is Jesus, the commander of the Lord's army, will blow the trumpet. He's holding it, and he blows it himself, not the seventh angel. And don't forget, in Daniel 12, we're told exactly when the seventh angel will blow the seventh trumpet. And Daniel chapter 12 says it's 1,290 days following the fifth seal abomination of desolation event in Jerusalem. That tells you to the day when Elijah and Moses is going to rise. That's the 1,290 day, how long shall you be angry, or how long till the fulfillment of these things be, countdown. That one shall not be shortened. We also know from Daniel 12 that we have 45 more days that Daniel has to keep watching. He has to wait patiently. There's the hold fast, keep your garments, wait patiently for 45 more days. You see that in Daniel 12. That is to the seventh bowl, when Jesus will personally hold and blow the last trumpet, that great trumpet blown with the great sound. All right, which is also Zechariah 14, return of Christ. Now, will that 45-day period be shortened? And the answer is yes. Jesus is going to have to come back a little early. And you say, why? Because of Zechariah 14. There's not going to be any elect, no flesh will be left alive in Jerusalem. Remember, Israel's already defeated. One-third of the nation of Israel, according to Zechariah 13, has already gone into captivity. Now the only thing left is these inhabitants of the city of Jerusalem who are being besieged, and we know the length of the besiege, that they're going to be besieged, and that's found in Ezekiel chapter 4. It's 430 days beginning at the sixth trumpet blast, when the 200 million army goes forth, and the city of Jerusalem begins their being besieged. It's 430 days, which shall be shortened from the sixth trumpet to the seventh bowl. We already know the bowls of wrath are 45 established days, which, of course, will be shortened. That tells you, using Ezekiel 4, the length of the sixth trumpet. It's going to be 390 days long, 13 months. That's also the length of the fifth seal. That's interesting. 13 months, 390 days. Isaiah 32, Isaiah 7, and Isaiah 8 call the length of the fifth seal the year and some days. Oh, you complacent women, you're going to be sorry for what you're doing to my followers of Jesus during the fifth seal. You're going to pay for it, you complacent women of Israel, when the curse and the oath come upon the land at the sixth seal. That's Isaiah 32, Isaiah 7, Isaiah 8. Now, I wanted you to see that. That's the pouring of the seventh bowl, the last day of the age. John chapter 6 tells you four times when Jesus blows the last trumpet immediately following the pouring of the seventh bowl. And another way you know that the pouring of the seventh bowl is the return of Christ in glory and power, and the way you know that is because of what's written in Revelation 16, 15 and 16, 16. Behold, I am coming as a thief. Bam, pouring of the last bowl. All right, the last day of the age. Jesus tells you in red letters, hint, hint, stomp, stomp. I kept telling you, behold, I'm coming as a thief. And then in Revelation 16, 16, he tells you, this is it. This is what you've been waiting on. Boom, pour the seventh bowl. All the nations have been gathered into the wedding hall, good and bad. Matthew 22. And now it's time to have the glorious and powerful, amazing appearing of Jesus Christ above Bethlehem Ephrathah. And as we're told in Zechariah 9, the world winds come out of the south from in the inhabitants, from the perspective of the inhabitants in Jerusalem who are being besieged, and the flood of jihad comes pouring into that gap in the wall that was built with untempered mortar. That's Zechariah 14, verses 1 and 2. Here we are back in Isaiah 13. Let's finish it. We now know who the My Mighty Ones, that's those experienced warriors of Ezekiel 37. We know who the My Sanctified Ones are in Revelation 19. That's the bride of Christ, who aren't experienced warriors, who have not had to die in battle for Almighty God. All right, they're all members of the bride, and they'll all be assigned to those four whirlwinds mentioned in Numbers chapter 10. Now, here we go, verse 4, the noise of the multitude in the mountains, like that of many people, a tumultuous noise of the kingdoms of nations gathered together. What is this about? This is about the good and bad being gathered together into the Middle East that you see there in Matthew 22. So many of them, good and bad, are going to be gathered into the winepress around the hill of Nazareth, the wedding hall, and many will be gathered together around Baghdad, the Babylon, the great city. Now, this is talking about the return of Christ at the seventh bowl. But we know that these assembly of great nations from the north, mentioned in Jeremiah 50 and 51, talking about the good being gathered to the Middle East to help fight this battle of Yah versus Baal, if you will. The Lord of hosts musters the army for battle. They come from a far country, from the end of heaven. The Lord and his weapons of indignation to destroy the whole land. Yeah, because the whole land has been taken over by the tares and by the beast kingdom. All these perjurers who have the mark of the beast. They are completely taken over the whole land from the Euphrates to the Nile. And maybe much of the Western world. That I don't know the answer to. But we do know that Revelation 3 tells us this hour of trial, mark of the beast test, shall come upon the whole world. And then Revelation, it talks about the whole world's going to marvel and follow after the beast. But Father spends 99% of his time talking about the events that shall take place between the Euphrates River and the Nile River. So that's why it's hard for me to give you a lot of specifics on what's going to happen to the Western world, or maybe to Indonesia and Malaysia and China. It's hard for me to give you specifics. But here they come. His weapons of indignation, right here in Isaiah 13:5. When we go to Jeremiah 50, I think it's verse 25. We'll see it when we get there. Father again is going to... Only two times in the whole Bible does he talk about his weapons of indignation at the appearing of Jesus Christ. All right, the weapons of indignation is the bride army consisting of the My Sanctified Ones and the experienced warriors from Father's past that he delights in, and the ones he chooses to bring back to life. He brings back them as part of the bride army too, the My Mighty Ones, to help lead the My Sanctified Ones in these four whirlwinds that go forth. But his weapons of indignation not only include the bride army dressed in fine linen, clean and bright, riding on their white horses, mode of transportation, which is called the chariots of Israel and the chariots of fire. They are not only part of the weapons of indignation, but so is these man of dust bodies, who are the good that Matthew 22 talks about. They may not all be saved, but they are coming. All right. They may not all be chosen to be glorified, but they are coming on behalf of protecting Israel and Christianity and putting an end to the beast kingdom. So his weapons of indignation, you also see in Jeremiah 50, is talking about all the armies, glorified and man of dust bodies, that are going to rejoice at the exaltation of the Holy One of Israel and the true Messiah, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Don't ever forget that Jesus is the Jewish Messiah. We like to think of him as the shepherd of our flock, and we like to separate ourselves from my people Israel. Israel, my elect, Zion. Well, guess what, brothers and sisters? You need to stop that. You need to stop that. You are Israel, my people, my inheritance, Zion, the moment you get grafted onto that tree of life. You need to fear God and quit trying to separate yourselves from Israel. You are Israel. That's exactly where your change of address form is going to be reflected at the post office. You're going to be living in Zion. You're going to be serving the Lord in Zion. You're going to be residents of Zion. Get used to it. Jesus is a Jewish Messiah, and he will reign throughout the millennium as a very Jewish King. You need to get used to it. The millennium, all the verses in the Bible that talk about the millennium, make it very clear that he's going to be bringing back sacrifices. The law shall go forth. The tabernacle of David shall be built. It will be called that as well as the Lord is there. Ezekiel chapters 40 through 48 are going to take place. It wasn't a mistake by Father, and all of a sudden he changed his mind. Okay, let's do the new covenant thing, and then none of that stuff is actually going to take place. Brothers and sisters, you've been deceived. All right? Israel shall rule the planet, led by their King Jesus. All right? You are Israel. Get used to it. And if you truly understood that, you would be keeping the seventh day holy. You would. That doesn't mean that you have to for salvation, but once you understand that it pleases Father, and it's used as a teaching tool, and it will be used as a teaching tool throughout the millennium, once you realize that, you will start having a service on Saturday, followed by going out into the communities and doing the work of Christ. You would do that not because it's required for salvation. You would do it because you have finally come to understanding and knowledge of who you are, and that it pleases Father to get together, to assemble on the seventh day, to proclaim Father's seven-day plan. And how you can realize that we're coming to the end of 6,000 years and the millennium is the seventh 1,000-year period, and how you can see that and deny that Father's not trying to tell you to assemble and keep the seventh day holy, you are blinded. Hallelujah. Enough on that subject. Let's finish up Isaiah 13. Here comes the good and bad pouring into the Middle East from Malaysia, Indonesia, India, Pakistan. Some people are coming to fight for Israel in the name of Jesus, and some are coming to wipe it off the face of the earth. But we know who the weapons of his indignation is. Again, you'll see that in Jeremiah 50, verses 25. Now let's finish up. To destroy the whole land, wail, for the day of the Lord is at hand. It will come as destruction from the Almighty. Now let's get these titles straight. Day of the Lord versus the title Great and Awesome Day of the Lord. And some versions call it the Great and Terrible Day of the Lord. Are these all referring to the same period of time? And the answer is no. Once you get this straight, brothers and sisters, it's going to help you tremendously. The Day of the Lord is the sixth seal, when the sun and moon goes dark over Jerusalem, that's Amos chapter 8, at exactly noon, the sun and moon will be disgraced the first of three times to signify the curse and the oath has come upon the land, immediately followed by the loosing of the seventh seal and the blowing of the first trumpet, all the same day. Ba-bam, bam, bam. Okay? But again, it's time to don sackcloth, you rabbis who just got finished 390 days of rounding up all the Christians and Holy Bibles because you thought Gog was the Messiah, and Gog will go forth from Mosul, Iraq. The Bible is very clear. It's not going to be Tyre, Lebanon. It's not going to be Pergamos, Turkey. The Bible makes it clear when you understand the first 10 verses of the book of Nahum and understand that it's talking about the day of your power, your glorious appearing of Jesus Christ at the seventh bowl to fight the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Once you see that in the first 10 verses of the book of Nahum, chapter 1, and then in Nahum 1:11, you see that the wicked counselor, who is the arch nemesis to the wonderful counselor, now we're talking about the wicked prince of Israel, Gog, who, when Father sends strong delusion to those vessels of dishonor rabbis in Israel today, many of them will think that he is the Messiah. But anyways, Nahum 1:11 proves that the wicked counselor, the worthless shepherd, the foolish shepherd, Gog, that Israel will accept, will come from Nineveh, Mosul, Iraq. And then Nahum 1:14 calls Nineveh, Mosul, Iraq, the vile city. Don't forget, the New King James Version calls Gog the vile one at the loosing of the first seal, shown in Daniel 11, verse 21. Daniel 11, 21 is the loosing of the first seal you see in Revelation chapter 6. And it's when the vile one who understands sinister schemes, who shall take over the kingdom by intrigue, come in peaceably. The one with fierce features, the one who plots evil and wickedness against the Lord, the God of Israel, and wants to wipe off the name of Israel from the face of the planet. He tricks them, all right? Crafty counsel. It says that he, the vile one, shall come forth from the vile city. That's Nahum 1:14, Nineveh. And then Nahum chapter 1, verse 15, the very last verse in Nahum chapter 1, proves once and for all that we're talking about the 70th week of Daniel, false Messiah or Antichrist. And the way it does it, it uses a verse from Daniel 11, verse 40. You see it right there in Nahum 1, verse 15. It talks about how the final Antichrist shall never, ever, ever, here's the key phrase, pass through the mountains of Israel again, or Father's land. Pass through, you match that up with Daniel 11, verse 40, which is when Gog heads south at the sixth seal. And you also take note of the first 10 verses of the book of Nahum, which proves we're talking about the last day of the age, the day of your power, the pouring of the seventh bowl, after all the nations have gathered into the wedding hall and throughout the Middle East, good and bad. They are in place for the appearing of Jesus Christ, to make them ashamed, to burn them with fire, and to use his weapons of indignation to gather the Israeli slaves for many days as he threshes from Baghdad to Cairo. All right, where are we at in Isaiah 13? Here we go, verse 6. Well, for the day of the Lord is at hand. Again, the day of the Lord is sixth seal through the end of the sixth bowl. And at the pouring of the seventh bowl begins what's called the great and awesome day of the Lord. You see that in Joel 3. You see that alluded to in Isaiah 28, the awesome, terrible work of Yah, his unusual act for many days, when this overflowing scourge coming down from these four whirlwinds shall thresh Father's land for many days. So the great and awesome or terrible day of the Lord begins when Jesus appears to render his vengeance at the seventh bowl. Again, this is a good time to remind you of what all Jesus is going to do at his appearing. What does Jesus do at his appearing? Bring peace to the world. That comes later. What Jesus does upon his appearing is he musters the armies of heaven. He marries his bride. He judges the nations, good and bad, who have assembled into the Middle East, especially the mountains of Israel, to include the besieging of Jerusalem. He makes war with these nations who have come against him. He, remember, Jesus is the commander of the Lord's army. That's what Revelation 19 tells you, too. This is war. And he avenges the blood, innocent blood, of his servants and his and their brethren. Avenges the blood of his servants. And the last thing that Jesus does at his coming, and this takes many days, is he also gathers the remnant of his people, these Israeli slaves. So every time Jesus and the weapons of indignation get a military victory over a beast city, just before he burns it, he gives time, if they hurry, for the Israeli slaves who weren't glorified to get them out of these cities before they turn into Sodom and Gomorrah, if you will. Jesus does all of those things at his appearing at the seventh bowl. That's not being taught in church today. It needs to be taught in church today, because when you teach that, you understand the 70th week of Daniel. You understand the fifth seal passage. Let's turn there now. In Revelation 6, you got to get this straight, brothers and sisters. Revelation chapter 6, when it's talking about the loosing of the fifth seal, if you want to understand these how long countdowns I keep talking about, found primarily in Daniel 8 and Daniel 12 and Daniel 11, you need to get a good handle on what's going on at the fifth seal. Here we are, Revelation chapter 6, verse 9. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. Do you see that word slain, brothers and sisters? Look at it closely. All right, hold your spot there. Go back to Ezekiel chapter 7. Excuse me, Ezekiel chapter 37. The exceedingly great army that stands on its feet at the resurrection to life. Remember, we're talking about the My Mighty Ones, the experienced, those who have died in battle. Well, guess what? The word slain is used right here in verse 9 of Ezekiel 37. All right? Breathe on these slain that they may live. And here we see that word slain again. This is why I love the New King James Version. The fifth seal loosing, it says, who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. So that answers my earlier question about whether those martyrs of Jesus who are not experienced war fighters, do they still fall under the category of My Mighty Ones found in Isaiah 13? And the answer is yes. How did we prove that? By using the word slain. So, and we already proved that even though Ezekiel 37 is talking about the resurrection to life of the entire bride of Christ, it's giving special shout out to the My Mighty Ones of Isaiah 13, who are mighty because they are experienced war fighters who have fought for Israel for thousands of years. Do not think that the bride of Christ is only people who have died in the last 2,000 years. The bride of Christ is all elect branches on the tree. Remember, the tree is a natural olive tree. We, as followers of Jesus, are grafted onto it by the final vine dresser, Father. And once we are grafted onto the tree, we are adopted. But there's only one tree. There's not two trees. The tree is called Israel, my elect. We are living elect branches on the tree. But that word slain answers the question of whether martyrs of Jesus, who are not war fighters, are still given the title of my mighty ones compared to just my sanctified ones, the basic bride of Christ. Okay, now, what kind of reward will you get for being a my mighty one versus a my sanctified one? I don't know. Maybe You just get a higher rank in the war. And the war shall last, Isaiah 28 says, for many days into the millennium. This is not a matter where Jesus comes back and within 1 hour, the entire Middle East has been cleansed and all Israeli slaves have been set free. That's not the case. In fact, some Israeli slaves won't be set free for months because they have to use, the Bible says, the highway of holiness to get back to Jerusalem. And it's got to be built during the millennium. So, and another lesson I'm going to do is whether all flesh around the world will see the appearing of Jesus Christ, or is it only the cities in which Jesus visits to render war? What does the Bible mean by all flesh? You know, I'm going to do a lesson on that, but I found a verse that proves that all flesh is not the whole planet, because it talks about Jesus is going to command those who are left alive from the nations that come against Israel. They shall be sent forth to go to the ends of the world to tell them what they saw. So that proves that all flesh is talking about the nations that have been gathered into the between the Euphrates River and the Nile. That's going to be an interesting lesson I'll do in the future. But I wanted you to... Oh, here we are at the loosing of the fifth seal, verse 9 through 11. Isn't that interesting? These are the 9-11 passages of Revelation 6. This is the fifth seal loosing. All right, and look what it says. How long, O Lord? This is talking about the how long countdowns found in Daniel 8 and Daniel 12. How long, O Lord? Holy and true, until you judge and, key word, brothers and sisters, avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth. The avenging of the blood of the martyrs. All right? It's a countdown. Where is that countdown found? It's found in Daniel 12. It's 1,335 days. Because if you go to Revelation 19, you'll see the answer to when the avenging comes. That question is being asked by the martyrs under the altar. How long till you avenge? Well, what seal, trumpet, or bowl does the avenging come? And it's right here. Here's the word avenge in 19 verse 2. For true and righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth. In fact, with her fornication, and he has avenged on her the blood of his servants shed by her. And then we see, if we turn the page, that Revelation chapter 19 is the glorious appearing of Jesus Christ. All right, at to fight the battle, the great day of God Almighty. So that countdown found in Daniel 12, the 1,335, that starts at the fifth seal abomination of desolation when the midnight cry is heard and Christians and the Holy Bibles begin to be rounded up in Israel, especially Jerusalem, and they begin to be scourged, and all the things that happened to Jesus are going to happen to them. Yes, Christians are going to be here. All right, we're not going anywhere until Jesus musters his army for battle. In fact, we are the reason why the world's going to hear the testimony of Jesus Christ, and there's going to be many martyrs. And those slain will stand on their feet at the appearing of Jesus Christ at the seventh bowl. All right, let's go back to Isaiah 13. Is it a long lesson? Yes. Is it worth it? I think so. The amount of questions that you have that are being answered, I hope, is incredible. And I hope it's a blessing to you. Well, for the day of the Lord is at hand. Now, is it talking about the great and awesome day of the Lord at the seventh bowl? Yes. Well, no. Let me stop. Because the remainder of Isaiah 13 is going to talk about the difference. It's going to literally show you the difference between the day of the Lord versus the great and awesome day of the Lord. So here the day of the Lord is talking about the whole day of the Lord. And then it's going to show you the difference between the two. The great and awesome day of the Lord here in Isaiah 13 is going to be called the day of his fierce anger. And The original Day of the Lord, sixth seal through sixth bowl, is given the title Wrath of the Lord of Hosts, here using the New King James Version. So you have the Wrath of the Lord of Hosts, which is the day of his anger, which is the Day of the Lord, sixth seal through the end of the sixth bowl, until all the nations have been gathered to the wedding hall and the rest of the Middle East for the appearing. And then at the pouring of the seventh bowl, the day of the Lord, or the day of his anger, or the wrath of the Lord of hosts, now climaxes into the cup of fury when the cup is filled with the fierceness of his anger. Now it's called the great and awesome day of the Lord. It's also given the title of day of his fierce anger. And it has some other titles as well. And of course, Israel is going to go through labor pains. And what is the child that's being born? It's the kingdom when Jesus appears. All right, in Israel, my elect stands on their feet. That's the birth of Israel, my elect. And the kingdom of God has come to the earth. And Satan will be put in chains for 1,000 years. But here we go, we'll come on down to verse 9 in Isaiah 13. Behold, the day of the Lord comes cruel with both wrath and fierce anger. Did you catch that? Now you know that the day of the Lord is the whole period. But the seventh bowl is actually given additional titles. But the day of the Lord, some people say, well, the day of the Lord is from the sixth seal through the end of the millennium. And some will say it's from the sixth seal until the many days of the millennium are done, when the Lord is done threshing and cleansing the land and setting the captives free. And so it depends on how you look at it. All right. But you need to know the difference between the wrath of the Lord of hosts and the day of his fierce anger, different than just regular anger. That's Revelation 16, verses 17 through 21. Don't forget, the book of Isaiah, chapters 24 through 30, is where you go to read about the seventh bowl. There's other places. You know, Micah 4, Micah 5, Isaiah 41, Isaiah 66, Joel 3. There's all kinds of places you can go to read about the seventh bowl. It's not just the book of Revelation. In fact, there's very little spoken of about the battle of the great day of God Almighty in Revelation 16, verses 17 through 21. Well, I tell you what, I'm going to let you, brothers and sisters, read the rest of Isaiah 13. And then, of course, I want to point out, though, some verses in Isaiah 13 before we move on to Jeremiah. Again, in verse 13 of Isaiah 13, just like Isaiah 9, you see the day of the Lord broken up into wrath of the Lord of hosts, and then the seventh bowl battle, which lasts for many days into the millennium, the day of his fierce anger. See the difference? And it talks about the earth will move out of her place. We got to get these earthquakes straight. There's going to be an earthquake in the land of Israel at the sixth seal. There's going to be an earthquake in Jerusalem at the seventh trumpet blast, when 7,000 people exactly will die as Elijah and Moses are rising up to heaven. And then there is the seventh bowl earthquake that we see in Revelation 16, verses 17 through 21. All right, that's another earthquake. I used to think that was a worldwide earthquake, and it might be. But the Bible specifically talks about the nation of Israel being hit by this earthquake at the return of Christ. So it may not be the whole world. What else do we want to point out in Isaiah 13? I need to recharge my battery here. I'm starting to get a little worn down, and you probably are too, but I'm going to determine to make this all one video, because if I break it up into parts, nobody ever watches parts 2, 3, or 4. Check this out, Isaiah 13, verse 17. Behold, I will stir up the Medes against them. This is exactly what you see in Jeremiah 49, 50, and 51, which we're just going to highlight key verses in those three chapters. Who are the Medes? The descendants are the Kurds today, which will help come against the beast cities during the end of the 70th week of Daniel. The Kurds will be joined this assembly of great nations from the north that we're getting ready to read about. It's funny how it's mentioned right here. And here in verse 19 it says, "In Babylon, the glory of kingdoms, the beauty of the Chaldeans' pride." Chaldeans matches the land of Shinar verses that we see in Zechariah 5. And don't forget how we prove that Baghdad is Babylon, the great city. Always has and always will. Remember, we proved that earlier. And this matches Revelation 17 and 18, the fall of Babylon. All right, let's go ahead and turn over to Jeremiah 49. Again, Jeremiah 49, 50, and 51 are talking about the end of the seventh trumpet period, and especially the seventh bowl battle, the great day of God Almighty. Don't forget, the weapons of his indignation are manna dust bodies who rejoice at his exaltation, teamed up with Jesus's glorified army consisting of the My Mighty Ones and the My Sanctified Ones and the angelic army. Don't want to forget about them. If you want to know who Jesus and his army are going to be fighting when we get glorified, you could read chapters 48, 49, 50, 51. Here's something really cool. I want to point this out. This is Jeremiah 48, verse 20, talking about Jordan, all right, that's going to be destroyed when Jesus comes back, the country of Jordan. Here it says, "Wail and cry, be ashamed, O Moab." Why? Because so many of their people are going to have the mark of the beast. It says, "Tell it in Arnon that Moab is plundered." Okay? This plundering must come by the man of dust bodies led by the general that's from the assembly of great nations from the far north. All right, this must happen at least days or weeks before the seventh bowl is poured, and I'll tell you how I can prove that. First of all, Arnon is talking about the fords of Arnon, which you see in Isaiah 16. I've recently done a video, you'll look on my video list, it's getting a lot of hits. I prove in the video called Revelation 12 Explained, Her Hiding Place Found in Scripture, the Wadi Mujib. That video people are really being blessed by because it explains who the woman of Revelation 12 is. It's the daughters of Zion that flee in time, Matthew 24. And I prove it by using Isaiah chapter 16, first five verses. Use the New King James Version, brothers and sisters, because if you go to the regular King James Version and some other versions like the NIV and such, it makes it a little harder to understand. It almost seems like the principal group of people being talked about are the daughters of Moab, and that's not the case. Isaiah 16 verses 1 through 5 are all about what Jesus is talking about in Matthew 24. It's talking about the daughters of Zion who are watching, who when they see the abomination of desolation spoken of in Daniel, the prophet in the book of Daniel, when they see that, they don't even go back in to gather their winter clothes or their diapers or their milk. They flee Jerusalem and Judea as fast as they can. Isaiah 16 talks about how the daughters of Zion will be sent. It also refers to them as the followers of the Lamb. Send the Lamb, meaning send the followers of the Lamb to the ruler of Jordan, Moab. That's what it says in Isaiah 16, verses 1 through 5. And it says, send them to the fords of Arnon Ravine, where they will be sheltered under the shadow of the wings of Almighty. And the daughters of Moab, the Christian daughters of Jordan, will be given the mission to help protect their sisters, the daughter of Zion, at the fords of Arnon Ravine, which is at the southeast corner of the Dead Sea, actually in the country of Jordan today. Now, when you research the fords of the Arnon River or ravine, you see that it's called by Jordan today the Wadi Mujib, W-A-D-I space M-U-J-I-B. If you were to go on the YouTube search bar and type in Wadi space Mujib, you will find dozens and dozens and dozens of videos done by people who have gone there, because it is a major tourist attraction in the country of Jordan. These mountainous ravines, this rock in the wilderness, these caverns, these canyons, all right? This is where the woman of Revelation 12 is supposed to flee to. Commanded by Almighty God, send the followers of the Lamb to the ruler of Moab, and he will take them by the daughters of Moab to a temporary Mount Zion, which will be set up in the fords of the Arnon Wadi Mujib ravines, this rock high up. And Psalm 27 matches it and shows that these are called my outcasts, the sheltered ones. This is where you will go and dwell during the 42-month trial, hour of trial, mark of the beast test. If you flee in time, you will not have to be a martyr for Jesus. All right? But I saw that here, so I had to point it out. Now, this means that Moab is going to be broken before these daughters of Zion are glorified. See, they're still hiding in these ravines of Isaiah 16. That means the seventh bowl has not been poured. They have not been glorified. Tell them that Moab has been broken. So when does Moab get broken? It gets broken during the 45 days of the seventh trumpet period by the assembly of great nations from the north. So Father will unleash his man of dust weapons of indignation during the seventh trumpet period prior to resurrecting at his appearing at the seventh bowl the rest of his weapons of indignation, the ones that shall be glorified, his my mighty ones, my sanctified ones. Here it's the man of dust, crusaders and Kurds that are whooping butt, softening them up for the return of Christ. Does Jesus need help? No, but it's Father's plan. So that proves right there, that proves, and I had a question about this. This proves that the weapons of indignation armies will have victories prior to the glorification of the daughters of Zion hiding in the ravine of the Wadi Mujib. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for answering my questions as I teach these lessons. That's exactly why I do these lessons. They're not just for you. I learn as the Holy Spirit leads. Hallelujah. So, these countries like Edom, in northern Edom, Saudi Arabia, and Basra, which is the King Khalid military command center there in north of Riyadh. All of these places are being mentioned in these chapters. Isaiah 46, 47, 48, 49, 50. These are the weapons of indignation, manna dust bodies, crusaders, and the Kurds having military victories before Jesus appears at the pouring of the seventh bowl. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Now, I keep talking about the weapons, his weapons of indignation that we saw in Isaiah 13. Where is it mentioned at in Jeremiah 50? I think I told you verse 25. Let's take a look. Here it is right here. Jeremiah 50 verse 25. The Lord has opened his armory and has brought out the weapons of his indignation. In the land of the Chaldeans, come against her, this is Baghdad, from the farthest border. All right? You indeed, O Baghdad, O Babylon, you have been trapped. You see that there in Jeremiah 50, verse 24. You're being trapped by the assembly of great nations from the north. I keep talking about this assembly of great nations from the north. Where are they listed at? Well, right here they're listed in Jeremiah 50, verse 9. The assembly of great nations from the north country. And you may say, hold on, brother, hold on. How do you know that's not the assembly of nations from the north that team up with Gog to form what's called the Assyrian Alliance to be used as Father's rod of indignation against Israel at the sixth seal? How do you know this is a different group of people? Well, you've got to read all of this. All of this goes on after the seventh trumpet blast. Now it's time to bring about the fall of Babylon. And these rejoice at the exaltation of the Holy One of Israel. They're coming against Babylon. Do you see that right here? Come against Babylon. Come against Babylon. Okay, this is not the Assyrian Alliance. This is the Crusaders and the Kurds in the spirit of the Medes coming to the land of the Chaldeans, to Baghdad, to the land of Shinar, to come against them during the seventh trumpet 45-day period, which shall be shortened by a few days. Matthew 24. No one knows the exact day. And you may say, well, didn't Daniel 12 say exactly 1,335 days from the abomination of desolation? That's the day that Daniel will arise to his inheritance at the seventh bowl. That's what it says, but we're told in Matthew 24 that established amount of time shall be shortened because there'd be no flesh left alive in Jerusalem. Zechariah 14, if Jesus didn't come back a few days early. But it's a no later than date. You can know the no later than date once the abomination of desolation is set up in the temple at the loosing of the fifth seal. You see here in Jeremiah 50 passages like verse 13, which talks about hissing at her plagues. I mean, this is the fall of Babylon, obviously, in the future. This matches Revelation 17 and 18. This is not talking about the past fall of Baghdad when the Medes were brought against them, King Nebuchadnezzar in the past. No, this is the future. This is our future, the 70th week of Daniel. This matches Revelation 17 and 18, the return of the Lord. So there's your weapons of indignation. You see the assembly of great nations from the north during the seventh trumpet period. We've proved that they begin to have military victories before the glorification of the My Sanctified Ones and the My Mighty Ones. We prove that by that verse that we just read in Jeremiah 48, verse 20. Oh, that's so important. That proves that point. Thank you, Lord. Continuing with some highlights. This is interesting. Have you ever read Jeremiah 49, verse 38? Jeremiah 49, verse 38. I will set up my throne in Elam. Again, we're talking about the 45 days of the bowls of wrath that leads up to the glorious appearing of Jesus Christ when he raises his army. All right. But of course, these crusaders and Kurds are considered the weapons of his indignation, parts of them. I will set my throne in Elam, that's Iran, and will destroy from there the king and princes, saith the Lord. What in the world does that mean right there in Jeremiah 49:38? This is key, brothers and sisters. When Elijah and Moses are seen rising, Iran will realize that they were fighting for the wrong side. Now they will turn against Saudi Arabia. They will turn against Jordan. They will turn against Iraq. They will turn against Syria. They will turn against the beast faction in Egypt. Not everybody in Egypt is evil, is wicked, but many are. So Iran when Revelation talks about the ten horns will turn against the beast cities once Father and Jesus remove the strong delusion at the blowing of the seventh trumpet when Elijah and Moses are seen rising, the ten horns will turn against the beast cities and be used by Father to help bring about their fall. That does not mean, however, that Father will forgive them for taking the mark of the beast, but he will surely use them. Here we see Iran will be used by Father during the 45 days of the bowls of wrath to start bringing about the fall of the beast cities. So Iran will, listen brothers and sisters, this is important, Iran will join forces with the crusaders and with the spirit of the Medes, the Kurds, during the last 45 days. I'm not saying they're your friends throughout the 70th week of Daniel. I'm just saying after Elijah and Moses have been seen rising, then Iran will realize that the Holy Bible was right after all. Iranians are not stupid. They don't have this deep hatred for Israel as much as it sounds like they do. It's not even as bad as the people of Gaza, Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, people that surround Israel. Father can remove all the strong delusion he wants. They will never forgive Israel for the last 6,000 years. But countries like Iran, Father will use them. He'll remove the strong delusion from Iran, even though it's too late if they took the mark of the beast. They will acknowledge the Holy Bible is true and side with the Crusaders and the Kurds to bring about the fall of Baghdad, Tyre, Lebanon, Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, all right, Raqqa, Ramadi, Mecca, all right, Iran will wise up. Now, are they going to use nukes? I don't know. I used to think so. Now, I'm not so sure Father wants all that radiation in his land. Can't say for sure. But that's interesting. I hope that answered a lot of your questions about the future of Iran, the future of the Crusaders and the Kurds, and what's going on during the 45 days of the Bowls of Wrath. Keep reading Jeremiah 50. It's all about the same subject. Note here in verse 16, it matches Revelation 14 and Joel chapter 3. This is talking about the fall of the Babylon kingdom, which is many cities. All right. They start having victories. We prove that using Jeremiah 48 in the verse, I think it was 20, about fords of Arnon, daughters of Zion in hiding, and how they'll get the news that the fall of Babylon and its cities has begun. So this harvest is talking specifically about when Baghdad falls at the appearing of Jesus Christ. But it starts to be attacked during the 45 days. But the actual true harvest is when Jesus appears and blows fire on it after his slaves have had time to flee Baghdad. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, read Jeremiah 50, read 51. All right. Behold, a people shall come from the north, a great nation, and many kings are raised up from the ends of the earth. All right, they shall not show mercy on the beast cities. Against you, O daughter of Babylon, Baghdad. All right, is another verse talking about that assembly of great nations from the north. Here they come. Team up with Iran. But Iran is not your friend until the seventh trumpet blows. And when Babylon has finally fell. This is interesting. Well, here's the general. I said a general will be appointed to lead the crusaders and the Kurds, and to team up with the kings and leaders of Iran during the 45 days of the Bowls of Wrath. You see it right there in verse 27. That's that banner that you read about in Isaiah 13. Blow the trumpet, prepare the nations and kingdoms against her. But here it says, Israel shall be used to break in pieces the beast cities and to repay Babylon, led by Baghdad. All right, this is talking about my sanctified ones and my mighty ones. This is the glorified Israel. Now you may say, okay, well, what happens to the Israeli slaves as they're being freed? will they also fight as man of dust Israel? And the answer is yes, they will. Hallelujah. So, Israel, glorified, Israel, non-glorified, are going to be fighting. But most of the fighting done by Israel is referring to the glorified, my sanctified ones, the glorified, my mighty ones that you are mentioned in Ezekiel 37. Them graves burst open. We're talking about a glorified army. Remember Revelation 19? If you read verses like this and go, oh yeah, that's just the slaves as they're being freed by the crusaders. They are given tanks and fighting vehicles, and they will also fight against the beast cities, and has nothing to do with the Bride of Christ glorified army fighting. You would be wrong, brothers and sisters. You would be wrong. All right, you need to read the whole Bible. Revelation 19 by itself makes it clear, but you also need to read Isaiah 41, Isaiah 66, Micah 4, all right, Ezekiel 37, Isaiah 13. With you. This is glorified Israel, led by Jesus, the commander of the Lord's army. Do not deny the resurrection to life. People need to be careful who tend to not talk about the resurrection to life and how we're going to rule the planet for the millennium. These man of dust bodies need to see the priest of Jesus being a glorified warrior, where 1,000 man of dust bodies would flee when you sneeze. I mean, they need to be that afraid of you. You're going to show them love and teach them during the millennium as you rule over them. But if you showed any signs of being perturbed or getting angry, they would immediately flinch after what they're going to see you do for these many days of the millennium. Hallelujah. Read Psalm 18. Learn about your new glorified body. Brothers and sisters, we're going to end this lesson here. I always end the lesson wishing I had took more time and taught you more, but there's always other lessons we can do. I happen to look down and see Jeremiah 51 verse 49. It says, as Babylon has caused the slain of Israel to fall, so at Babylon the slain of all the earth shall fall. Okay? And then of course that's the getaway flee you see in Revelation 17 and 18. When Jesus and his army is about to unleash fire and brimstone and hail, 66 pounds hailstones onto Baghdad. But the wine press is actually, the main wine press is around the hill of Nazareth. There'll be a big battle there too. Hallelujah. Slain. Brothers and sisters, I hope this has been a blessing to you, and I cannot wait to see you next time. God bless.